Okay. So the last major concept of this chapter. So last class, we looked at relating Gibbs energy to cell potential and how do we calculate cell potential. Now we're going to loop this back around and relate cell potential to our equilibrium. So now we looked at that and said, like, oh, we can calculate equilibrium from E cell. Mm-hmm. Now, not everything is going to be done at standard conditions. A battery is not always going to be run at one molar concentrations of products and reactants, and so cell potential is actually going to vary. So we need to know how would we calculate cell potential for non-standard conditions. Just the same way as we related Gibbs non-standard to Gibbs standard by RT ln Q, we can relate cell potential standard to cell potential non-standard, because we can exchange Gibbs is equal to negative NFE. N is the moles of electrons, F is Faraday's constant. And if you carry this through and divide by negative NF, you get what's called the Nernst equation. Probably won't use this too much, but it is of some use. It relates the cell potential actually experienced is the standard cell potential minus a constant, minus our temperature, minus the moles of electron and another constant, times ln Q. Remember, Q is our reaction quotient. Q is our reaction quotient. Now, at standard conditions, all the concentrations are one. And so all the concentrations cancel it. Now, and say natural log of one is equal to zero. And so E standard is equal to E non-standard. When Q is equal to K, then you actually get that the RTNF LNK cancels out with E standard. And then we have, and then E cell goes to zero. Basically saying a battery, if you let it run long enough, it will reach equilibrium. You let the battery run long enough without recharging, it'll reach equilibrium and then it essentially dies. You can get no voltage. You turn your lights on your car, you turn off your car, you leave them on, come back in the morning, suddenly your car won't stop. No, your car won't start. It's because you've let the reaction go to equilibrium. All the battery's fully discharged. It's not going to produce any more it's not going to produce any more voltage. And so you're going to have to recharge it some other way. Now, but basically what this means is that the equations that control the concentration can strengthen or weaken the voltage depending on how much reactants, how much products we have. Remember, when we solve for a Q expression or a K expression, we do not include pure liquids, we do not include pure solids, we only include aqueous phases and gases. So that's going to limit what's going to be in our Q expression, especially if we have a lot of, especially if the electrodes are metal. Now, one of the things this is useful is a concentration cell, where the enon standard's dependence on concentration leads to some unusual situations. So you could have two cells of a battery being the exact same. The oxidation cell being hydrogen going to hydrogen protons going to hydrogen gas, and the reduction cell being hydrogen gas going to hydrogen protons. So it's just literally the same thing on the other side. Now, if you set that as E cell standard and you subtract them, it's going to be zero, regardless of what it is. Now, it just so happens hydrogen is already zero, so zero minus zero is zero. But if I did copper on one side and copper on the other, it would the E cell would be zero. But by controlling the concentrations on each side of the cell, you could favor one being the oxidation and one being reduction, and you can actually make a voltage and control it between there by just running it through. This is the same premise of how electrical eels generate their shock to stun their prey. That essentially they kind of have a system of biological channels that shuttle ions from one side to the other and generate a concentration gradient. And that concentration gradient is going to be building up the charge that once they let it go and let the reaction occur, you're going to generate some voltage here as the battery, essentially the internal battery, discharges. So just looking at this, if we use the gas, we assume the hydrogen gas is one atmosphere no matter what, and you have a cell that is pH 3 and a cell that is pH 7. So one cell is pH to get to the concentration of hydronium, it's 10 to the negative. Oh, it's 10 to the negative pH. So the concentration of hydrogen in one side is 10 to the negative third. The other side is 10 to the negative seventh. So just looking at that. And actually, I think I screwed this up a little bit. The main thing being that based on this balanced chemical reaction, this should be squared. Two hydroniums squared, two hydroniums squared, two hydrogens squared. So how would that change? No matter what, it's definitely should be squared. So right now I've calculated this for that, but how would this change if this was squared? 10 to the negative seventh over 10 to the negative third is 10 to the negative fourth. I square that. So why am I squaring that? Let me go ahead and note. Here's where I goofed up. I'm the first to admit. Q equals products over reactants. So the one reaction is H plus squared over H2. The other guy is H2 over H plus squared. This is for the oxidant and this is for the reductant. So we can't just cancel the guys out. So they're not the same hydrogens. Because just looking at that balanced chemical equation for two electrons. So squared it, that's Q is 1 times 10 to the negative 8th. Take the negative log of that. I multiply by my 8.314. Multiply by my temperature, divided by my two electrons, divided by my Faraday's constant. And actually, this should read 0.237 volts. So a little bit stronger than I'd written down there. And I'll fix that later in post. But the idea here is that just by putting a acidic pH on one side and a neutral pH on the other, you can create this concentration gradient that's going to be 0.2 volts, which is enough to give you a nasty shock. Is it going to be super spontaneous? Going to be so spontaneous that the K is blown out of the water? No, but it's enough to stun some prey. It's enough to be a deterrent. Probably don't want to touch that again. Okay, so let's calculate this. So let's imagine we have sodium solid, water goes to hydrogen gas and sodium hydroxide. If 10 grams of sodium hydroxide are dissolved in 1 liter saturated with 0.00075 molar hydrogen gas, what is the E non-standard for this reaction? First, easiest thing to do, what is our E cell? What is our E cell standard? We're going to take, as written, the reductant, and as written, what is being reduced? Water is being reduced to hydrogen and hydroxide. Well, that's negative 0.83. Sodium is being oxidized to sodium salt. So since this is reverse of what you'd expect, we have to subtract it. This is going to give you the more spontaneous result. So negative 0.83 plus 2.71.
This is like the same thing we did yesterday, that the backwards reaction or whatever. Backwards one.
The backward reaction, we subtract the backwards reaction.
And then that makes our E cell.
That makes our E cell standard. That makes our E cell standard. This is equal to our E naught. That is our E naught. Now our E cell non-standard now accounts for how much sodium, how much hydroxide, and how much of everything. So our Q is going to be all products. Hydrogen, Na plus squared, and OH minus squared. All over one, because sodium solid doesn't get included. Water doesn't get included. Pure liquids, pure solids, not included. So the first thing is, what is the molarity of sodium hydroxide? The molarity is equal to mass divided by molar weight divided by volume. The mass is 10 grams. The molar weight of sodium hydroxide is 40 grams. It's 23 for sodium, 16 for oxygen, and 1 for hydrogen. That's 40. Then we divide that by 1 because it's in 1 liter.
What's the top one for, on top of molarity?
Mass.
Okay, mass.
Yeah, mass divided by molecular weight divided by volume. So the molarity of sodium hydroxide is 0.25. And because this is a strong base. That means it's going to fully dissociate into 0.25 sodium and 0.25 hydroxide. So our Q is equal to 0.00075 times 0.25 squared times 0.25 squared. Or essentially 0.25 to the fourth. Times that by our hydrogen. Our Q is equal to 2.9297 times 10 to the negative 6. Negative 6. I'm going to erase some of my stuff. Erase this. Just so I can have some room to work. So, now calculating my E cell standard now. E cell non-standard. So we have 1.88 minus R T 298. Please note, cell potential depends on temperature. So we can see this drop as cell potential goes down. How many electrons are lost? Well, 2 from sodium, 2 from water, so it's 2. 2 are lost by sodium, 2 are gained by sodium. Well, no, sorry. 2 are lost by sodium, 2 are gained by water. And Faraday's constant, 96485. Natural log 2.9297 10 to the negative 6. So let's plug that in.
Can you explain how you got the 2 you got from the least common denominator of the electrons?
2 and this whole thing times 2.
Okay.
Yeah. So I can plug this in all at once, or I could plug in what is the back half. I'm going to do it in two parts just so we can see the effect. So I'm plugging all this mess in. 2.9297. And that is going to, this is not going to be a huge change. This guy is going to make this whole thing positive 0.16, we'll say 4. 1.88. And so, what does that mean? It's like our voltage under this condition has gone up. Our new voltage is now 2.04. It's never going to be a huge change unless you have literally almost no products or almost no reactants. But it will be a change because notice, E cell would be, if this was 1, this was 1, and this was 1. And instead of this being 1, 1, and 1, this is a quarter, and 0.00075. So, I mean, this one's kind of tweedly because
why'd you do the molarity one? Like, would you got the 0.25 for hydroxide, and why would you do that? Like, where are you getting that stuff?
Why?
Well, I see it says right here, so 10 grams of sodium hydroxide.
Because Q only uses molarity or pressure. K, you can either have a KP or a KC. You can't have a K mass. You can't have a KG. Because when you're looking at equilibrium, you're looking at it in terms of molecules. And the only way to look at this in terms of molecules is to look at it either as a gas or moles or add or like molarity, because each atom weighs differently. And so we can't just say, well, 10 grams of sodium and 10 grams of hydrogen, because 10 grams of hydrogen is going to be a lot more atoms than 10 grams of sodium hydroxide. So we can't use the same, we can't use mass when we work with these. But as I said, Nernst equation is kind of a little twiddly, kind of engineering-ish, because it, like, you never see a huge change, but you do see a change. So it's one of those things that's kind of like annoying, but it needs to be done for like the people who actually this matters for. I mean, okay. Now the last concept, which is not too, well, there's a couple more things we need to talk about this chapter. If I keep saying last concept, it's going to look silly. So electrolysis is something that happens. That so far we've really been working through equations that have been spontaneous. We have a positive E cell that they will run. They will produce energy. They will generate electricity. They will shock you. But not all redox reactions are spontaneous. So it is possible to have a negative E cell. It's just this is a non-spontaneous reaction. And it will require work for it to run. But some processes are worth the work. Just the idea of like an electrolytic cell can take in an input voltage to force a non-spontaneous reaction to react. Such as it is possible to split salt into its components at each electrode. You'd have to put some electricity in, but it's possible to do this. This is the idea of how do you chrome plate an object? How do you put chrome plating on something? You take a chromium solution, you dip your object in there, you have electrodes attached to the object as it's dipped. I mean, you have essentially wires attached to the object as it's dipped in, and you run the current through the object, and it will, the chrome will deposit on the surface. You're running electricity through, and this is such a regular process that you can know what type of coating you can put on there, how thick a coating for how long it's going to take to get that thick of coating. Say, like, if I want 5 inches thick coating of chrome on the surface, I know I need to put this in for so many hours. Because we can actually calculate that, and that's one of the last types of math that we'll do. But thank God we can do this, or else a lot of batteries would be single use. Your car battery that we're going to talk about a little bit later, it's like, well, you use it to start the engine, to like run your headlights and your electronics. Well, if we didn't have a way to recharge this, if we didn't have a way to put some work from the engine once it's running back into that battery, it would eventually run down and you'd have to buy a new battery. But because we can put work back in, we can make the spontaneous reverse reaction flow. And if we make that flow, we put everything back where it goes, and the battery's fresh and like it's never been used. We can keep using that for quite a long time. I won't lie and say you can use a lead acid battery forever, but it can have a pretty long life if you take care of it. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and stop this right here before we get into this math, and we will come back in a few minutes. So rather than start this math, we're going to end this video for right now. So I'll start the new one in just a minute. Welcome back. I'm going to finish up with talking about electroplating. The idea is like how long does it take to generate so much solid? Now, to do this, we need one more type of physics number. We've dealt with voltage before. Now we're going to deal with what's called current. The current is in units of amperes, or A. But what is an ampere? An ampere is defined as a coulomb per second. It is the literally speed of electron transfer. Because a coulomb is the charge of electron. It's a way of measuring the electronic charge. So just like a velocity is measuring the distance traveled per second, a current is measuring the amount of electrons transferred per second. So what we're going to need to do with this, what we need is we need to be able to use our current with the time of deposition to figure out how much electron charge is transferred. Then we're going to convert that amount of electrons transferred into moles of electrons and use that moles of electrons to figure out how much mass could be electroplated. So if we look at the units, current, time, molecular weight, moles of electrons, Avogadro's number, or Faraday's constant. So all these units we should know. The only thing new is I, which is our current. But looking at the units, I want you to see the units. Coulombs per second cancels out with seconds. You have coulombs on top, cancels with coulombs on bottom to give us moles of electrons on top. Moles of electrons on top cancels with moles of electrons on bottom, giving us units of moles, and then grams per moles give us units of grams. So essentially, we can calculate how much grams of metal will be transferred over a period of time. Now, if you want to get really mathematically nitpicky, which we're not, you could calculate the thickness of the plating based on the density of the metal and the surface area we're trying to electroplate onto, but God, no, we're not doing that. It could be done. It's all mathematically set up for you. You'd have to use density, which would give you a volume of metal produced. And then you divide by the surface area that you're electroplating onto to give you a thickness. But as I said, let's see this in practice. So the only trick here is you have to make sure you convert into seconds to match amperes. So let's look at this. Just writing this out. This one's already worked out for us, but how long would it take to electroplate 20 grams of chromium, 3+, using 5 amps? So let's write down what we have. We have the mass already given, 20. Here's the hard part. The hardest part is always going to begin the moles of electrons. It's not maybe always obvious. So to go to chromium solid, we would need 3 electrons. So N is going to be 3. Our current is 5. And what is our molar weight of chromium? Molar weight of chromium, we got to look up on our table. Let's see, chromium. I got a table right above me, so stand up real quick. 52, if I'm not mistaken. Of course, it's written down. 51.996. I'm going to just say 52. That's close enough. Grams. So what are we doing? We're saying, and then this was the original equation I gave you. IT molar weight for NF. Now, how do you get that to the other side? here's where you use your math. Well, to get the bottom parts to the other side, you're going to say multiply both sides by NF. Cancels there, NF. To get the molar weight and I to the other side, so that it's just T molar weight times I, cancel those, divide by, oh, for God's sake, weight and I. And so there's the equation I just, for God's sake, what the hell just happened? So there's our equation. We just rearranged the one equation to solve for time. Then we're just plugging things in. Say 20 grams, takes 3 electrons. Faraday's is a constant. Our current is 5 amps. And the molar mass is 52. Plug that in mathematically, you get this huge number of seconds. But then you take that huge number of seconds, you divide by 60. Still get a big number. 267.43. Still get a big number, 371 minutes. Divide again by 60. You get 6.19 hours. So you could just say, put that on, come back in 6 hours, a little bit past 6 hours, and be like, okay, turn off the voltage, and you have 20 grams of chromium deposited. So it's really easy to do. The only problem is sometimes the chromium you have to use can be a little toxic material, so you got to be careful.
Can you eat it?
No. Well, you can eat it, but it's like what they say. All mushrooms are edible. Some mushrooms are only edible once. So let's how much zinc could be electroplated using 10 amps in 1 hour? So our current is 10. Our time, 1 hour, is 60 minutes, which would be 3,600 seconds are moles. Zinc 2 plus, we're going to the neutral zinc, would be, so it needs 2 electrons. And Faraday's is given, so the molar weight of zinc is the only thing we need. Up that, oh, it's, I'd like to say 65.4. 65.4. So let's ITMW NF is going to be our mass. Plugging that in. 10 times 3,600. Times 65.4 divided by 2 and divided by 96485 would give us, that would deposit 12.2 grams. Not sure.
So this is electroplating?
This is electroplating.
What is, so is that like, I don't know what that is. So what's like, what do you mean by electroplating? Like, what is it?
Well, it means to electronically coat something. If you want to put a metal onto another metal from solution, and you're not, and you're going from aqueous, there's two ways to coat a metal or coat an object. You could dip something in liquid metal and let it freeze and harden on it, like a candy-coated shell. Or you could use electricity to take it from a water-based solution and coat it onto there. So you could take, like, say, oil, like a steel foundry, a molten iron and dip something in there and coat it. But if you did that and it was too hot, your object might melt, or your object might like burn up. So you might lose the object. You're not going to be able to coat. You might be able to coat an object with it, but you might lose it. So it all depends. Now this, you could just dip the object in water. You dissolve, say, zinc nitrate in water. You just take some zinc, you put some, it's all dissolved, you have a solution, just concentrated zinc solution, and you just run a current through your object. And as long as the object can hold a current, you can coat the surface. Like, anyone make any jewelry? You ever see any of the jewelry wires? It's like silver-coated copper wire, where they put a thin layer of silver onto there. All you do with that is you dip the wire, the copper wire, in a silver solution, and you'd run a current through it, the wire, and the silver would then deposit on the wire. And so you have just this thin little coating, just enough that it's silver on the outside and copper on the inside. It's not going to maybe corrode, but that way you don't have to make the whole wire out of silver. So you can save money. Silver's expensive, copper's still expensive, but less expensive than silver. It's the way you can also electroplate gold onto objects. So it's just a way you coat an object that didn't normally have it. So it's like, if you've ever had chrome wheels on your car, they're usually chrome plated. They're not actually 100% chrome, or else they'd be like way too expensive. And then of course you get in a wreck and it's like, okay, now I have to take out a second mortgage on my car. So, yeah. Now the last clicker. Last clicker. It's just a verbal one. Once again, send me an email if your clicker is not working. What is the best description of electrolysis? Flow of electrons is used to cause a non-spontaneous chemical reaction to occur. Flow of electrons is used to increase the speed of a spontaneous chemical reaction. Spontaneous chemical reaction is used to recharge a battery. Or spontaneous chemical reaction is used to create a flow of electrons. So. So think about this, not too hard. Could be a little tricky. It's the best description of electrolysis. There's some. I'll give it to 2:30, so we had 20 more seconds to get your answers in. Okay, well, totally expected a few more, but sure. Okay, so one of the key things of electrolysis is that it is a non-spontaneous chemical reaction. We are pushing, you're using electricity to push it in the opposite direction. So we're using a flow of electrons, say, current generated by some sort of motion to make something non-spontaneous occur. Okay. Okay, the last little subject is just fun stuff. We're just talking about different things that happen in this field of...
I have a question.
Yes.
So... in this section, we're talking about batteries and electricity, right?
Yeah.
How does the potato clock work? Or like the potato light thing, you see when they put like a potato, yeah, like two probes in a potato and it lights the light bulb up? How does that work then?
I'm trying to run. I mean, I'm thinking that has to do largely with probably a concentration gradient as you're like, the nutrient, the salts within that battery, that's kind of like a concentration cell. As the, like, the maybe the ions on one side of that potato are flowing to the cathode and the ions on the other flowing to the other. It's only going to last for as long as we can keep building up that concentration gradient until it's eventually dies. That's at least without really looking more into that. That's at least how I think. I think that'd be kind of like a concentration cell. I don't think, because it's not like you have an external source. You're just using the natural salt and nutrients in that potato to run it.
Yeah, because it probably wouldn't last very long.
No. Maybe that should be some homework. You make your own little potato.
I'm making a potato light, guys. So be ready for Friday.
And tell me how long that lasts for.
Mm-hmm. I already have a potato.
Okay, well there you are. But so batteries are probably the number one application of this. Now, right here, I just want to look at this graph right here. Is gravimetric energy density. So how much energy can you get per kilogram of substance? And volumetric energy density. How much energy can you get per volume, per liter? And you see right here, diesel actually gives you the most energy per volume and per mass.
Followed That's by why gas my diesel line. Truck's so good, boy.
Yeah. It does give you a lot of mileage. A lot of mileage. Gasoline, E85, a little weaker than gasoline. Ethanol is weaker than that, but of course, ethanol is a little bit more renewable than, say, gasoline. So, but lower energy density. M85, which would be methanol, and then pure methanol. Liquid hydrogen is way down here on energy density. 200 bar methane, like high pressure methane car, 700 bar hydrogen gas car. It's again pretty low energy density, but these guys are getting into the more renewable. So we're kind of, this is part of why we aren't already in a renewable fuel powered economy. We have a whole bunch of problems with low energy density gases and how do we store them and how do we use them? And look, batteries, way down here, this tiny little thing, this blow up right here is of that little screen. We have here, like, some of these are emerging battery technologies that aren't quite fully established, like zinc air batteries, lithium ion, new systems, lithium metal batteries, polymer. So like our computers and like phones are maybe over here. A nickel metal hydride, nickel cadmium. And finally, lead acid are probably the lowest energy density we have down here at the very, very bottom.
Do you think that batteries will ever take over the like automotive industry?
They might. If there's new things coming out, and it's just like the idea is like, you know, the hybrid cars that you run mostly on the fuel cell, and then you like, a little bit of charge, a little bit of gas to recharge it, and then you keep going. Because the one of the big things here that these are the shittiest energy per weight, but they can store energy. You can undergo multiple reuses, and so it's reusable. They have low amounts of waste, and actually something, if we get into the real physics, electrically powered work has the highest efficiency. If you're looking about gasoline, it has a lot of energy. How much of that actual energy can you turn into car energy? And it's like, I'm trying to remember if it's like 30% or 40% of the energy that you get from burning gas is turned into work. Something crazy like low. Diesel is slightly more energy efficient.
So why haven't
It's like we're wasting a lot of energy here, and the batteries can get 100% efficiency. The problems here is, one, you have to have a long lasting battery. You have to have it get multiple uses, and it's just part of it's also like you have to keep making them. You have to make it so it's readily accessible and a lot cheaper. If you can make it cheap, then everyone's going to want to do it. But right now, you know, like you try to buy a Tesla, you need to get this subsidized by the government to be able to afford a Tesla, you know, or you have to be a billionaire.
Right.
So, I mean, it's not really something you can go out and buy. Like you could buy a beater Ford, like off the lot, just fine. But
eventually they'll get like that. Like you said,
yeah, you'll eventually they'll get cheaper and cheaper as they find ways to make this cheaper and cheaper. But it's like one of those things you have to keep working on making. You can't just like, oh yeah, they don't come out maximized for a price. Right now it's just like, how do you make it? And then how do you make it cheaper? How do you make it work better? And we're slowly getting there. And I say emerging technologies are going here so we get higher energy density. And some of them is like, some of these guys are rare earth elements. So we got to find a way to use cheaper material where we don't have to strip mine like third world countries in order to make the batteries. So that's it. So I know a lot about lead acid batteries. I actually worked with some lead acid batteries and a battery company. And so I know like there's ways you can make these way improved. There's a way they're using like a carbon foam to like make lead acid batteries way less and get a lot more energy density out of them. So there's ways to improve it. It's just we're slowly getting our way there yet. We're not all the way there. You got to test it out and prove this is going to work and convince a bunch of people to buy it. And then as more people buy it, they're like, oh, wow, this works even better. But so I can speak pretty well about how lead-acid battery works. Lead-acid batteries follow this simple reaction. Lead oxide and lead solid in the presence of acid, sulfuric acid specifically, goes to lead 2+ and water. So both lead oxide, lead 4 goes to lead 2, and lead 0 goes to lead 2. Said the conducting solution is concentrated sulfuric acid, thus the lead acid part of the battery. There's some problems right here. Discharging this guy will lead to small crystals of lead sulfate forming, which this will assist the recharging process because the lead sulfate will kind of keep the lead from migrating away from the battery. But the problem here is if you leave the battery fully discharged for too long a period of time, the lead sulfate crystals get too big and they can't go back. So that's what happens if you let your battery die and then you leave it really long time before being discharged or being recharged. Maybe you're not going to get your battery fully charged ever back up again. The battery contains an anode and a cathode half cells. They're in the same electrolytic solution. They have a lead grid, and this is pasted with the lead oxide, or pasted with the spongy lead. And these guys are separated by a porous membrane called a separator. So it's actually, you have a plate pasted with this lead goo, a separator, and the other lead plate pasted with some other lead goo, and they're just smacked together, and you just keep on separator and keep on over and over and over again. And so the separator is going to prevent what's called electrical short circuit. If the two lead grids ever touch each other, they'll just react without any external current flowing. They'll keep reacting until they die. They'll just boom, short themselves out, because electricity will always take the shortest path possible. Electricity will go through the shortest path, and going through solution is a long path. Going through metal is a short path. So as electricity flows from one wire to the other side wire, that's always the shortest path. And it won't react itself as long as that wire is shut. But if the grids touch each other at any one spot, suddenly that wire is much farther away, and so it's just going to react through that wire and kill itself. He said, why do we still use lead acid batteries in our car? They're the shittiest of all batteries. Lead is cheap. Lead is dirt cheap, and we have a ton of it. That's kind of why. It's way too convenient to try to switch to something else. You can get a battery for like $50, $100. Imagine trying to get like enough AAA batteries to make your car run. Like, that's just crazy. So there's other batteries. You may have heard of alkali batteries. Your AAA, yeah, alkaline is basic. They work by a reduction of manganese and oxidation of zinc in a highly basic solution. Now, why most of the AAA batteries don't recharge? Because the nature of their active material, it's dispersed. That once they discharge, the material kind of falls to the bottom and you can't get it back. They don't stick their active material so it stays in place. So if you can't get the active material to stay where it needs to be when you want to recharge it, you don't have any like reactant left. You don't have any reagent left. You can't put back the mess you've made. Lead acid batteries, you can, because of that lead sulfate. Now, nickel cadmium batteries and nickel metal hydride batteries, very high energy densities, very good rechargeability, but they're limited use because of their toxicity. Cadmium's pretty toxic. And these lanthanide metal hydrides are kind of expensive because they're rare earth elements. And of course, lithium ion is kind of neat. It uses a completely different mechanism for energy collection than some of the others. Rather than using electrons to go from one side to the other, it uses lithium ions that are transferred from a cobalt oxide electrode to a graphite electrode. But really, this is the least understood of all the mechanisms. Like, we can see the electrons moving. This is the actual lithium ion bouncing back and forth between two different grids. So it's kind of neat, but not really as well understood. Now we'll finish up with corrosion. The other big thing that happens in this is corrosion. That essentially redox reactions where the metal is becomes oxidized. So rust. Iron ore, when you get it from the ground, is usually pretty oxidized because this is a spontaneous process. Iron will go from iron to FeO, to Fe304, to Fe203. It goes from 0 to 2 plus, to a mixed 2 to 3, finally a 3 plus. Oxidizing iron will change a lot of its properties, such as whether it's soluble in water, how strong is it, is it magnetic. Iron and iron, Fe304, pretty strong, pretty magnetic. Fe203, very brittle, very non-magnetic. You ever like touch the rust on your car, it kind of crumbles. But what it needs oxygen or protons and oxidizing agents such as water. So you get your car wet in oxidated water or acidic water and it will start to rust. So what do we do to prevent rust? And that's by coating something with a more more reactive metal, such as zinc. So if you ever heard of galvanized steel is steel, which is our basic iron coated with zinc. You put a protective layer of zinc all around that to shield it. Now, my actual PhD involved looking at galvanization. But how do they do that? They're going to essentially take a steel girder or whatever they want. They're going to clean it really well. They're going to burn off all the chemicals on the outside, rinse it, pickle it, rinse it, get it all prepped, and they're going to dip it into molten zinc bath. So they're not going to electroplate it. They're going to dip it into molten zinc because iron has a really high melting point. We can do this. And the zinc will just form a thin shell, like a candy-coated shell of zinc all around the surface of the iron. Now the zinc, they're saying, oh, whatever, it can rust all it wants because zinc doesn't become brittle when it rusts. And it will prevent the iron from rusting. As long as the zinc is there coating it, oxygen has trouble getting through. And oxygen is then just shielded from the iron. So it'll go through zinc oxide. It might bind to zinc to carbon dioxide and form zinc carbonate. And these guys will protect the surface for many, many years. So what it does, again, is that it puts a resistant shell that keeps oxygen from reaching the iron. So this is a protective shell. Now rust from iron is not protective. Rust will not prevent more rust. Rust actually makes it easier for more rust to occur. Rust is porous and highly soluble. So when the rust occurs, water sticks to there and allows the oxygen to get to the good iron and thus catalyzes more rust forming. So rust breeds more rust. And then zinc, another purpose of that is it's a sacrificial electrode. So say you hit a light post, you hit a tree, and you damage your zinc coating. And so now there's iron exposed. Well, the fact is, as the iron starts to rust, the zinc will instead react and reduce the iron back down. So long as there's zinc around to donate electrons, zinc will oxidize in the iron's place. And so that will protect the iron for a little bit longer. As I said, this galvanization is not perfect, but if you do this, it's going to extend the life of steel products for like tens and twenties of years, as opposed to like 10, 20 years more than what it would have been otherwise, especially depending on the pollution environment. But that's all I wanted to talk about. This is all the material that will be on the test. So I will work on test number 4. I don't know, maybe plan for Monday or something like that. Mm-hmm. But we'll continue on. I'll keep on posting videos on, like, say, Monday or so with nuclear chemistry.
Is our McMillan stuff still going to be due at the same time? Okay, I didn't know if you're going to move it back, move it up.
No, I'm not going to move it up. It's still, I'm going to leave everything due as when it's due, but that is all the material that's going to be on the test. Well, okay. Maybe on Friday, we'll maybe look at some practicing on, practicing for old test.
Okay.
So that is where we are. As I said, I'll post some videos about nuclear chemistry for those who are interested.
Can you show us how to make a nuclear bomb in our house?
Yes, please. I want to know.
I could totally show you how to do it. It's like, step one, get on certain lists. find a way to get uranium, cesium, cobalt. Atom Smasher.
I know a guy, Daniel. We'll be fine.
We're doing this.
Okay.
Hey, project for Smacks.
Yes. Yes. Demos.
Demos.
Okay. Anyway, so we're almost out of time, so I will see you guys on Friday.
See ya.
Oh, and for those who don't like and subscribe, blah, blah, blah.
Okay.